everyone. Welcome all. It's NCAA tournament action, the second round, as we have the University of Michigan and the Wolverines taking on Northwestern University as part of the Lake Show here on ESPN+. Hello, everybody. Alongside my broadcast colleague this morning, Noah Coffin, I'm Peter Ferrari. Noah, will the third time be the charm for Michigan? This is going to be the second time they've played in less than a week, and third time this season. Michigan hasn't been able to find the upper hand against Northwestern, but maybe they have a trick or two up their sleeve to change the fate for this third time around.
The historical numbers are working against Michigan, Peter. They're trying to become the first team to ever knock off the number one overall seed in the round of 16, and of course, 0-2 against Northwestern this year, but in the tournament, things can change with a drop of a hat.
And with that tournament action comes, of course, the leader of Michigan, and that's going to be none other than Hannah Nielsen. She, of course, was a Hall of Fame NCAA player for Northwestern University throughout her time, and she, of course, played for Coach Kelly Amante Hiller. So will the pupil become the teacher this time around? Again, maybe some wrinkles that Kelly hasn't seen before, but Kelly, of course, first time as the number one seed, Noah, since 2009.
And as we take a look at the bracket here, Coach Kelly Amante Hiller is trying to get her team back to the national semifinals for the third year in a row. They've won the tournament, Northwestern has, every time they've been the number one seed in program history. Can they do it again? Stony Brook, Loyola, Maryland, and Michigan will have something to say about that. We will see the quarterfinals of this region of the bracket this week on ESPNU, and then, of course, the winner onto the national semifinals. All four teams really making a tough bid for it.
Now looking at the starting lineups for the visiting Wolverines of Michigan, a standout, of course, is who is going to be in goal, and that's Santa Maria, alongside outstanding goal scorer Jill Smith. On the flip side for the Wildcats of Northwestern University, of course you could talk about Berkery, of course you could talk about Quinkendall, but of course, Noah, you gotta talk about the Skane train, Izzy Skane, one of the best players in the entire nation.
Absolutely, Izzy Skane has especially excelled against Michigan this year, Peter, though she's great against everybody. 11 goals and 4 assists in 2 games against the Wolverines this season, looking to have more success today in the NCAA tournament.
We welcome you all to the Lake Show. Lake Michigan in the background. It's the only thing that separates these two teams, and we will see where things go as, of course, coming away with the opening draw is going to be number 25, Madison Taylor, the freshman.
Madison Taylor, the Big Ten Freshman of the Year. She only won Big Ten Freshman of the Week 9 times, Peter, so it was a pretty tough choice for the Big Ten coaches when selecting the Freshman of the Year, but Taylor ended up pulling it out in the end.
You know, I talked to Assistant Coach Alexis just yesterday afternoon, and we talked about Maddie Taylor, and she said, Peter, we play a classless system. And I said, okay, explain that to me, Coach. What do you mean a classless system? She goes, every player that comes in, freshman to grad student, Quakendahl spins, Quakendahl scores, bang! First goal of the afternoon for the Wildcats, Aaron Quakendahl.
Well, one of Northwestern's captains getting the day started the exact way they want to. Quakendahl has had her share of success against Michigan this year. That's her 8th goal against the Wolverines to go along with a couple of assists, and she did it all herself that time, Peter. The spin for the win, and it's the Wildcats by 1 early.
You know, last year you and I had the pleasure of calling this very same matchup almost to the date, Noah, and Lauren Gilbert scored in about 12 seconds in that opening, after the opening draw. So Quakendahl took a little bit longer than last year.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, you didn't go out and say it, Peter, but I will. Aaron Quakendahl is slacking compared to what Lauren Gilbert did last year, and I think Lauren Gilbert would agree.
Lauren Gilbert, of course, one of the greats, one of the fastest players ever registered for Northwestern, has gone on to a professional career of her own as that one's pulled back. And
alternating possession there is the call from the official because the ball did not clear on the draw. So Michigan gets that alternating possession.
Look, going back to X, swinging near side now is going to be Federolf. Federolf, a sophomore, but one of the standout players for this Wolverine squad. Back to X. Swinging around, shot up, hits the pipe and drops. And of course, Sam White able to pick up the pieces, one of the unsung heroes for the successful Wildcats season.
Absolutely, as we see her trying to clear here for Northwestern, Samantha White, under-talked about for sure, Peter, with her success, but there's some great Michigan defending on the other end. Garvey with the forced turnover there for the Wolverines.
Of course, Michigan defeated Central Michigan just a few days ago. Similar story, Noah, in that Central Michigan scored first, and then next thing you know, Michigan countered with a 12-goal run of their own, spanning the course of multiple quarters.
Yeah, that's exactly what the Wolverines would love to replicate here today after getting off to another slightly slower start. That turnover will help them get the offense going after that first possession came up empty.
Michigan 3-5 this season on the road. And they are 3-4 when their opponent scores first. Lob at Liberty, the Tufts transfer, finding the high save.
Well, it's hard to blame Josie Gooch for going for goal there, but that's very rarely going to beat La Liberty, even with an open window, just a little too far away with Gooch's shot speed to really test the Wildcat goalkeeper.
So with possession now, the Wildcats, of course, a slim 1-0 lead. Again, for Noah Coffin, I'm Peter Ferreri. ESPN Plus's coverage of NCAA tournament action. Wearing the home whites with purple numbers and letters, black trim. Michigan wearing the visiting blues with, of course, the beautiful gold numbers and letters. Quick underhand pass by Koikendahl to the far side. Look for her to retrieve it. She gets it back. Man-to-man coverage right now, Noah, defensively for blue.
Absolutely. Michigan defense looking aggressive. I think one of them heard you call their maze numbers gold, Peter.
Yeah. Misguided pass, a rare mistake for the Wildcats, but possession now goes to Michigan.
Michigan really focused in on Aaron Koikin all that possession, got the ball out of her cross, made Haley Radigan, who's very capable herself, try to make a play, and she ends up turning it over instead of being able to reach Madison Taylor. Two turnovers in the last two possessions for Northwestern.
You know, something both coaching staff spoke about yesterday in our preview calls, as there's an infraction. Not sure if that's going to be a card issued.
And there's going to be a delay of game right here. Radigan did not get carded for the initial infraction, but she knocked the ball away from Michigan, and she will come off with a one-minute green card. I think that's a pretty easy call for that official there. Radigan has got to be a little bit smarter. You see, there's the initial call. Radigan didn't like it, and she just scoops it away from the Michigan player trying to get to it. A silly mistake for Radigan that will give Michigan the player advantage here.
Yeah, Radigan, one of the standout transfers for this Northwestern squad. Bit of a mental mistake right there, and that could just be the break that Michigan needs early on. You know, one thing we're talking about with, you know, Coach Nielsen, and she's like, we just don't want always to have to come back in every game or have to come back by 4, 5, 6 goals. We can, but it's harder to do against the best teams in the nation, and this is very much writing out to be a similar story.
Michigan has to work quick here. That penalty time already halved. If they want to take advantage of the player advantage, they got to work within these next 25 seconds.
And Jill Smith, one of the leading scorers in all the nation. Long fire, goal, number 42, Kaylee Thompson, the grad student from Bel Air, Maryland, ties it up at one apiece.
Well, Peter, I was just saying how Gooch's shot from about the same spot wasn't going to work. Well, Thompson brought a little bit more firepower there, really wound up and got into it, goes low on La Liberty and just beats her in the five hole there. Beautiful shot from Thompson, and this space is available to her because of the penalty. The green card comes back to bite the Wildcats. Playing 6-on-7 in the defensive end allows Michigan to tie this game up.
Thompson also scored the first goal against Central Michigan 48 hours ago. So rinse and repeat, down by one, tied it up quickly at one apiece. I'm sure Radigan is maybe having a conversation with the staff like, all right, don't do that again.
Sure.
You know, as we discuss, Noah, as players are in the circle, looking for draw control, spits near side, and Maddie Taylor coming away with it.
False start actually called there, Peter, on Michigan. They got Josie Gooch there going early, trying to beat Sam Smith, to the punch.
taken away by Michigan. What a turnover by Blue. Making a strong run, Jill Smith. Again, you probably have a lot of eyes on Jill Smith. Who else can beat us right now? Both teams having a very diverse offensive attack. Multiple players, Noah, as we saw so far, Thompson being able to put one in the back of the net.
And that time Smith showing her versatility as well. Her and Schwab combined to create the turnover and quick little run out there for Michigan. Wolverines have been ferocious on the defensive end so far.
Quick pass in. Oh, they're waving it off. They're waving it off. Stepping in the circle was number 9, Fedorov.
That was close, but it sure looked like Fedorov got in the circle from here. Has a little bit of a scramble on their back line for Northwestern. They're eventually able to prevent Michigan from gaining that lead.
Yeah, you saw her try to just take a scoot back after the right foot landed, but official was right on the spot. You heard a very ruckus crowd called for that as well here at Martin Stadium. So 1-1-year score. Down to the left to no avail is Izzy Skein, her first strong attempt in the morning. You know, so you have Michigan, which is, of course, you know, time ahead for the time zone. So afternoon, morning, until it hits noon Central Time. We're going to – we just won't talk about the time. How about that?
Sounds good to me. It was only Northwestern's second shot of the game as Allie Berkery scoops that one up and goes on the run the other way.
Izzy taking it herself down to the right. Thought she got pushed from behind, but might have just been a momentum shift to have her fall as such. But nonetheless, under 8 minutes now in quarter number one. Also to mention, Noah, that we've watched a lot and called a lot of Big Ten lacrosse this year. Violation again, I believe.
Yeah, yellow card is coming out here, it looks like, Peter. Or at least I thought something was going to come out there. Maybe not. Yep.
I did see a yellow. Okay.
They got Koikendall there. I think a bit of a frustration foul from Koikendall. She's been known to make a couple of those at times. The Wildcats offense has really been stymied here early. And again, Koikendall going from behind and the whole Michigan bench applauding really quickly for that whistle. As you can see, the head contact there always going to be enough for a yellow card. That's automatic yellow. And the second time that Michigan has had a player advantage early in this one.
Last time that happened, Blue took advantage of that, getting the equalizer. Let's see if they could do the same here. This is a full 2 minutes, not just the 60 from before.
And for Northwestern, regardless of how this works out for them defensively, the offense has got to figure something out. Michigan has been all over them, especially at the end of the transition. The Wildcats have really struggled with getting good looks out of that and even settling into their offense in general.
Long range, oh, thought about it. Thompson pulled back, far side.
Shooting space is going to be called there. Right. Looked like Mahoney just slid over a little bit late and a free position chance for Michigan.
Yeah, Michigan now, can they take advantage of this free position?
Michigan in free position.
Aaron Garvey, 29 goals, make it 30. Michigan takes the lead.
Michigan is going after the five hole of Molly Law Liberty, Peter. They've got it again there. Garvey, quick strike, gets in quickly. Very difficult for Law Liberty to make this stop, especially because Garvey got about 8 feet away before she released the ball. And an early media timeout here. Northwestern will welcome the break as they trail it 2-1 early in the first quarter.
Northwestern University and the NCAA promote good sportsmanship by student athletes, coaches, and fans. We request your cooperation supporting the student athletes and officials in a positive manner. Profanity, derogatory comments, or other intimidating actions directed at athletes, coaches, or officials, team representatives, or other fans will not be tolerated and are grounds for removal. We appreciate your cooperation in creating a safe and positive game environment. Respect, it's the name of the game. The NCAA thank official equipment suppliers Fiskars and Smitty for their support of NCAA championships. Their contributions help enhance the educational and athletic experiences of
For Noah Kaufman, I'm Peter Ferrari. Michigan leads 2-1. Two cards have yielded two goals, Noah.
Absolutely, Peter. But the real change and thing that Michigan has made happen so far in this game is their defense at the end of the transition period, at the restraining line. Michigan has put a lot of pressure on Northwestern, knowing that the Wildcats want to get into the attack quickly. They've caused a couple turnovers at that particular point, and both of those have led to the two cards that have led to the two Michigan goals.
One thing I've appreciated as well is how crisply Michigan has gone back from X to reset up their offense with multiple points of attack outside of the fan. Very crisp passing. Coming away with the draw control. So free position goal as discussed for Michigan. Can Northwestern respond? It's been a man defense so far for Michigan. Let's see if they continue it here, Noah.
And Sam White got the draw there, Peter. Northwestern now 3-1 on the draw controls, and the only one they didn't win was on the alternating possession. So they've dominated that draw circle so far. Hasn't shown up on the scoreboard yet, though.
Three fouls as well for Northwestern. Has not yielded positive results for them. Falling to the inside.
That's going to be a card. And Madison Taylor got hit in the head there as she was driving in. That's an automatic card again, as we just mentioned. And so another yellow coming out, but this time it's against Michigan. Let's take another look. From the backside there, I'm not sure that Taylor actually does get hit in the head. Grace Callahan goes off to the side. It looked at that angle, Peter, like the stick just missed the head of Taylor.
Close
who
call,
may have baited the refs into that yellow card, if you will.
Albeit, though, all the angles we saw were from, you know, the reverse side, so maybe there was an infraction from the front, but nonetheless, Cats reset up. You know, we were talking about Maddie Taylor earlier before the opening goal by Koikendahl, so just kind of finish that thought. When Coach Alexis said that, okay, we play a classless team, meaning whether you're freshman, sophomore, junior to grad student, if you can play, you're in the game. Long range shot by Skane. Retrieved back at X. Setting up now with 60 seconds remaining on the shot clock.
The Wildcats still having trouble penetrating this Michigan defense. Taking their time, though. Good knock away on the backside. It looked like that was going to be an easy look in the end for Hansen.
Defensive blue stands tall yet again. Northwestern almost 10 scoreless minutes now since the opening 60-second goal.
That's exactly what I said, Peter, about that pressure and transition. But at the same time, they're shifting a lot defensively, staying in that man-to-man, but a lot of movement. And again, just really ill-advised. I'm not sure what the thought process is there from Carly Mahoney as she approaches that ball. That's an automatic yellow. Yeah. And I just don't know where her head is at there, Peter. She's approaching all the way there, knowing that if she really goes for that, she's going to be going through the body of the Michigan player. I mean, it doesn't look good here for Mahoney.
Yeah, I mean, she just absolutely levels. I believe that was number 22.
Yeah, that's Montemurano there for Michigan, one of the captains. Not a smart play, and now we're back on level ground for the next 45 seconds until the Michigan penalty expires, which I think is what the Wolverines are going to wait for here.
Oh, no reason not to, but, you know, as discussed now, Noah, I don't want to necessarily use the word sloppy, but over-aggressive play by Northwestern has now led to four fouls already in the first 10 minutes.
Yeah, two yellow cards and a green card is not where the Wildcats want to be this early, and I do think they seem a little bit out of sorts. They maybe weren't fully expecting this sort of push from Michigan in the early going. Northwestern has been a slow-starting team at times this season. It's nothing new to them, but this is not where they want to be in terms of the cards and the time they're allowing Michigan, as we're getting very close to the first penalty elapsing.
Now a full 66 seconds for Michigan to try to go ahead by two. They already lead 2-1 here at Martin Stadium in second round action. Free position goal was the last time scored. First goal scored by Kaylee Thompson with the rifle from long range. Back at X, there we talk about the success, and that's going to be another infraction. Coming from behind, that'll be by Hannah Gillespie. Another free position, Noah.
Yeah, Gillespie here saves the goal by committing the foul, and she's not going to go off for a yellow card, but it's a nice free position chance for Caroline Bean.
Can Bean deliver? Shot knocked from behind. She took a bit too long to try to deliver.
That's possession clock expired. What a play from the backside. It looked to me like that was Jane Hansen who got in there and disrupted the free position chance. Bean wasn't looking for it, wasn't expecting it. And a crucial turnover by Northwestern to go from a clear Michigan chance at a score to now being able to ride out the yellow card with possession and get back on level terms.
Northwestern weathering the blue storm so far on an overcast afternoon in Evanston. And so penalty has been released now, Noah. Let's see what Northwestern can do at full strength.
And of course, there's been a lot of Michigan defensive focus on Izzy Skane, but they've done a really great job containing the cutters so far. No easy passes to the middle for Northwestern. See if that can continue.
Inside, box and roll, underhand shot. Haley Radigan, the transfer from Mercer, evens it up at two. Bang.
Well, that's why Haley Radigan is one of the highest scoring players in NCAA lacrosse history, Peter. You don't get to the top 10 by accident. She's got plenty of tricks up her sleeve, and the fake back to the strong side, going underhand. She got it all out there that time. The Wildcats needed a goal badly, and Radigan ends the drought with flair to level things at two.
You know, one thing about the transfers is they have, you know, I talked with Coach Alexis about it, especially that of Radigan and Liberty. I said they haven't just transferred in. They have taken over their roles. Radigan, a little slow start, but she said what happened is she had to be willing to be welcomed by our team. Once she was able to do that, you know, La Liberty from step one, hey, I'm part of it, let's go. Radigan, a little bit of a transition, but once she was ready to go, she has been a lovely secondary scorer to Izzy Skane.
An alternating possession. This time goes to Northwestern as the ball did not clear on the draw. So the Wildcats have a chance to really make it hurt here for Michigan, Peter, if they can get going. And once again, Michigan putting a little bit more pressure on their restraining line. Sam White that time, though, saw it coming. I think that's something Northwestern and Kelly Monty-Hiller, of course, talked about during that timeout we had with about 7 minutes to play in the first quarter. And the Wildcats since then have handled the pressure a lot more easily to get into the attacking third.
Coach Venichanos had to say Sam White, one of the favorite players amongst this Northwestern squad, unsung here. You want her to be defense. You want her to play mid. You want her to attack. She's the Swiss Army knife, can do everything. Falling to the ground, yellow potential. Looks like we got a cross check.
So that was interesting because the flag came up first for a potential cross check, but that doesn't have to necessarily be the call. If there was no cross check here, it was going to be a very interesting block charge right there from Taylor, but we can see the foul beforehand from Grace Callahan. Clear call and the right call and a chance for Taylor from the free position arc.
Maddie Taylor, right foot ahead, leans in, shoots. Beautiful save. Defensively, Maya Santa Maria says no.
Annabelle Burke crashed in really quickly on Taylor once the whistle went. She got off like a shot and got in her vision, obscured that shot, and made it a much easier save for her goalkeeper.
Swipe from behind by Radigan. Let's see if she decides to slow it down. She does to set up the offensive attack for Northwestern. A minute 40 remaining in the opening quarter, 2-2 your score.
High risk maneuver from Radigan there, Peter. She got up close to that head area, but had enough control of her cross to avoid contact and cause a turnover. Really nice play by the grad student.
Radigan already with a green against her for the delay of game. Koikendala yellow.
Don't have to be as worried, of course, with that green card. A yellow card will not remove you.
Shot left. Goal. Knock it down. None other than number 27, Izzy Skane.
Well, check out the two-woman game here. Erin Koikendahl sets a blistering pick, gets knocked over in the process, but frees up Izzy Skane beautifully. This is how the Wildcats create space for their leading scorer. Look at Koikendahl take the contact, get Skane free, and all Izzy Skane needs is a little bit of separation to fire that shot off and put the Wildcats back in front once more.
Yeah, I mean, really, Skane, it's not as if she needs help, but boy, oh boy, when you have that pick from Koikendahl, feet were planted, textbook.
Absolutely right, Peter. And we have seen Grace Callahan putting her body on the line for Michigan defensively. She was running right through that pick, didn't see it coming, and that freed up Skane there. Callahan has been a nuisance for Skane so far defensively, along with the rest of this Michigan defense. But Skane got one over on the Wolverines that time.
Coach Venichanos was joking that, you know, that since these teams are so familiar with each other, she said, we might as well just be, you know, sleeping in the offices. No reason to go home. Everybody's fired up, ready for what's to transpire today. Part of that, of course, being you know so much about each other. You know, when they talk about Noah, a week has gone by since they played each other. So, you know, you've already watched the game, Phil. You already know the nuances. So Northwestern now, Noah, has 45 seconds to try to get their fourth goal of the opening quarter.
And Radigan is navigating this Michigan defense so much better now. A lot more confidence for Northwestern now that they've made those early adjustments. And she draws another whistle and is going to get another chance from that 8-meter arc.
One part of the conversation about Radigan, she said, Peter, she had the willingness to learn and be part of the team. She said a lot of times you don't get that willingness. Radigan fires too far. Actually hit the goalpost on the opposing practice field. Pass in, Radigan tries again. Hits the ground and bounces up with 28 seconds remaining. Calling for it is Taylor. Bit too late was Koikendahl. Koikendahl pump fakes again. 15 remains. Far side to Skane. Do they isolate? Koikendahl with the run. Looks near side. 10 seconds left. Amante Radigan dropping it down. Back at X with 5, with 4. And coming away with it is going to be sent to Maria. And as time expires, 2-1 was the lead for Blue Michigan. But Northwestern came back with two of their own, Noah. They now lead 3-2, a thrilling first quarter so far.
And if you're Michigan, you actually have to be thrilled with only a one-goal deficit here, Peter. The Wildcats had an onslaught down the stretch of the first quarter, but Michigan made enough defensive plays to keep it at a one-goal deficit as we head to the second.
Ending of the second quarter, it'll be Northwestern 3, Michigan 2. It's NCAA Lacrosse on ESPN. Michigan trails 3-2 against the home Wildcats of Northwestern. For Noah Kaufman, I'm Peter Ferrari. Junior goalkeeper Maya Santamaria, she was the fourth goalie in UM history to eclipse the 100 save mark in a single season. She's also having a great season with all 9 games starting.
Yeah, she's been phenomenal, and she started off today really well as well, Peter. 3 tough saves on 6 shots on goal. It's really hard to keep this Northwestern offense down from the cage, especially with their shot power and ability. Santa Maria has held up strong. La Liberty, on the other hand, for Northwestern, has not been tested quite as much, but she's held her own, of course, all season long. the grad transfer from Tufts.
Well, Liberty named all Big Ten second team. She had 8 saves in the Big Ten semifinals. And her best performance as Wildcats against Maryland with 9 saves and 6 goals allowed. Also had 12 saves against Stony Brook. You and I were on that call. And dropping the, not quite sure if that was a yard sale, but nonetheless, White, triple team, stays on her feet. And again, that's the prowess of one Sam White.
Peter, the biggest stat in this game right now is the draw control stat, as another great save from Santa Maria on Izzy Skane. The fact that Michigan has kept it to a one-goal game, even though Northwestern has won 6 out of 7 draws, yeah, bodes well for the Wolverines if they can start to level that draw control category up a little bit. That was a very dangerous pass from Santa Maria. Got away with it with Mahoney lurking.
Fairly soft ride this possession by Northwestern against Blue. Phrase I heard recently, Noah, about, you know, the importance of winning the draw control is win the draw, rule the world.
Huh. Well, so far for Northwestern, that is not exactly translated. 6-1 on the draw control stat, 3-2 on the scoreboard. So maybe win the draw, rule part of the world.
There you go.
For them.
The greater Evanston area.
Exactly. Michigan slowing it way down on offense here. Surprised to see this.
Could be one of the wrinkles that was expected. You know, every quarter at half especially, Northwestern was expecting Coach Nielsen to throw some things in, maybe slow it down, limit the possession time for Northwestern. With 20 seconds left, let's see what Michigan can do from X. They've been successful thus far. Passing back to the top, sides have switched. Gooch fires. Gooch says, feed me more, as she gets the third goal for Michigan to tie it up at 3.
Well, a bit of a defensive miscue here from Northwestern. You got to recognize the shot clock running low and throw a little bit more earlier at Gooch. She doesn't have a lot of options here. She can't get to her shot, but Gooch does a really good job of driving left, keeping herself ready to shoot, and just getting it off. For Northwestern, that double, that second helper, has to come a lot faster than it did that time from Gillespie. But a great goal by Michigan, and they worked a lot of time off that clock in doing so. Excellent work by Gooch.
Gooch, her 10th goal of the season, evening things up against Northwestern. You know, a lot of people may have expected Northwestern to start hot and just run away with it. I was not one of them, because, again, it is so hard to beat the same team 3 times in a row, or do so by a large margin, especially when a week ago, you know, they just played. And so there's not many nuances or tendencies you don't know. And a lot of times with the frequency of play, that can favor the team that hasn't been on the winning end before.
Couldn't agree more, Peter. And again, the draws stay in Northwestern's favor, but they have to make more out of them on offense. Maybe they should take a page out of Michigan's book, take a little bit more time themselves. Their turnovers have come early in the clock, by and large.
Michigan, a fairly younger squad by all intents and purposes overall. Would love to make a run after their victory against Central Michigan.
And they're going to call this goal back from Amonte. The whistle came beforehand on the shooting space call. Amonte was ready to score.
Yeah.
But instead, she'll have to take the free possession chance.
Well, and she's one of those players, Noah, that has been the 1B to the 1A of Izzy Skane multiple times this year. Down goes too far. And coming away with it is Michigan, and that'll be number 6, Callahan. So making a full sprint is Gooch. Good job by Michigan. You might hear their fans in the crowd traveled very well. Down to Evanston. West to Evanston, you could say.
Sure. A little bit down.
You could go down around the lake.
For Northwestern, Peter, it's not necessarily about taking more time, but I think taking more time would help in getting some closer in shots. They've taken a lot of shots from farther away, and a lot of that is credited to Michigan's defense, who hasn't let them penetrate much, but Wildcats need to be a little bit more patient in pushing to penetrate that Wolverines defense to me.
Well, that's a situation too, Noah, where right now it's playing to Michigan's hand. Side shot goes wide to the left pipe.
Good shot look from Kaylee Dyer there.
I would say shot clock will now reset. Quick pass in. No whistle is going to be called. Or is
they,
it
they
gonna
did.
Be called?
They did. Okay. A little bit of a delayed whistle there, but the push was called. And they'll reset for the foul.
Well, it's going to be a situation now, Noah, again, for these past few minutes. It puts more pressure on the Northwestern defense. The quicker Northwestern offense takes their shot and potentially misses, right away it goes back defensively for Northwestern, especially with the game tied. Dodging to the inside, back out, down, goal, beautiful goal, number 14. It was only a matter of time for the Farmington Hills product. Jill Smith gives Blue the lead, 4-3.
An excellent goal from Jill Smith. She gets a big time running start here against Sam White, gets past her, takes that significant contact in the middle from Emerson Bolig, and scores while falling away from the goal. The referees are gonna talk this one over briefly, it looks like. At least it looked like they were going to. The yellow flag was up for Bolig. No card comes out because of the goal, of course, but Smith took a while to get up and now looks good to go.
Yeah,
but the referee's talking something over in the middle of the field here, Peter.
Not quite sure it is. Might just be like, hey, what did you see in case? Could have been in case the goal wasn't scored, what would have been your call? That does occur sometimes. But sophomore Jill Smith, she already broke both the Michigan single-season scoring record and single-season points record.
I will say, Scott Hiller, very displeased on the Northwestern sideline right now.
Yeah.
Not sure what the argument is exactly, but he is not liking something, and he's letting the referees know about it.
If I were a mime stick reader, it could be the aggressive follow-through that Smith had.
Sure,
maybe coming
sure.
through, and he saw his arm go all the way to the ground. You know, it wasn't just a flick of a wrist. That could have been, you know, a dangerous infraction offensively for Michigan. And you and I have seen that call quite a few times this year.
We saw it, in fact, on Friday between Michigan and Central Michigan. We had a dangerous follow-through yellow card.
Draw control by Blue, Maddie Burns out of Germantown Academy.
And finally, Michigan gets on the board in the draw circle, and now they look ready to go. I mean, the Wolverines right now are taking control of the second quarter. Really impressive showing out of the break for Hannah Nielsen's squad.
Yeah, Hannah Nielsen has this team, and here's the other thing I appreciate about our conversation yesterday, Noah. Lighthearted, laughing, joking. You know, you may not have sensed that to be a premise of the conversation when you know what was staring down the barrel, but nonetheless, she was lighthearted about it. She said, we know what we're up against, but we've seen them so many times that we know what to expect. One goal lead for Michigan with 10 minutes remaining in the second quarter, taken away by the Cats.
And Jane Hansen running the other way. She's got a potential to score on offense as well. I couldn't quite connect with Taylor that time.
Looked for the opportunity was there, but Michigan was getting back pretty quickly defensively. So now there's a situation, Noah, where you have discussed, does Northwestern slow things down, try to find a good shot, or if anything, relieve their defense just a bit? Kuykendall goes near side of the fan. Tries to set that screen again for Skane. The slide was there. Left Kuykendall open and just sailed over the head of number 7, L. Hansen.
Shooting space called as well on that Kuykendall shot. And the Wildcats have found a lot of success with that two-woman game, regardless of who's screening, all season long. And Kuykendall there on the pick and roll, if you will, found herself open for the shot and gets free position chance. Not the number one person you would think about in these free position chances for Northwestern, but Kuykendall capable of scoring here.
Off the left elbow pad of Santa Maria as she says, thank you, next. Michigan, full sprint ahead. Passing inside. Oh my goodness! Highlight reel goal! Are they waving it off?
Follow
a
through.
A card. Oh,
follow
my through. Goodness. There is, again, maybe that was something, Noah, that they discussed. Say we have to keep our eyes open for that follow through, that dangerous follow through. That is what Northwestern was possibly screaming for. Last goal called this time.
Yeah, that's just brutal for Michigan. I mean, it's really tough to see something like that on such a highlight reel play. It was an incredible goal for Kaylee Dyer.
but the follow through, let's take another look at it here. Ooh, I don't know about that, Peter. I really don't know about that as a yellow card. I'm not sure Dyer actually made contact with the Northwestern player with her stick. That is a really tough way to take away a really great transition goal for Michigan. And now to put the Wildcats a player up. Michigan has not gotten the breaks with the referee's call so far this game.
Tough ride defensively from behind. Maddie Burns really putting the pressure on the Cats as Northwestern now still trails by one with 8.5 remaining in quarter number two. As it looks
this might be, I was trying to see if that was shooting space or maybe 3 seconds. It wasn't clear what the referee was signaling for, but either way, shooting space for Kuykendall.
Yeah, I didn't quite see the arm action, but nonetheless, we sit 4-3. Can Kuykendall tie it up? Hit off the left elbow pad of Santa Maria last time up. Passes off.
False start. That's on Michigan. So Kuykendall's going to have a little bit more space to operate with there. Michigan's been trying to get off really quickly defensively on these reposition looks to try to take away the angle for Northwestern. It's worked, but that time just a little bit too quick for Garvey. And now Kuykendall from the same spot with a lot more room to operate.
Kuykendall looks for the quick handoff to Amante. Goal! Amante tying it up at 4.
That's exactly what the false start opens up, Peter. It forces two Michigan players behind Kuykendall. They're already down a player on the yellow card. There just aren't enough defenders to cover the backside. Kuykendall looking to pass the entire way, and Amante just comes wide open. There's not a lot Michigan can do defensively in that sort of situation, but the Wildcats make it happen. And that yellow card released quickly, but what a change in this game. That dangerous follow-through, Peter, takes it effectively from 5-3 Michigan directly to 4-4 to a 4-4 tie. We will certainly look back on that moment later in this game.
Yes, we will. Dylan Amante, her 29th goal of the season. The fifth leading scorer for this squad behind Skane, Kuykendall, Radigan, and Taylor. But again, we talked about every game, it seems, there is a 1B to Izzy Skane. Who's going to step up and get those other goals? Because you know Skane is going to get hers. Amante has been one of those players all season. Tied up at 4. And coming away in the circle again. Looks to be Leah Holmes. Excuse me, it's going to be number 19, Sam Smith. My apologies.
Yeah, Smith has been dynamite in the draw circle so far, Peter. So much so that Northwestern, who often changes between her and Serafina DeMuno, hasn't even made that switch yet. It's been all Smith, and she used her speed there to get to the ball first. She's been all over the circle so far for Northwestern.
When you think about, too, Noah, the transition Northwestern had to make. So last year, of course, made it to the Final Four, couldn't quite bring it home against North Carolina. But a situation, misguided pass, that's going to be on the ground. Michigan picks it up, loses it again. Ground ball picked up by Skane. Skane looking for the outlet pass. Finds Hansen. Skane looks for it again. Taylor keeps it herself. Near side. Thought about the shot. Retreating. Outstanding defense by Michigan. Not allowing any breathing room so far this possession. Radigan. Dodges. Spins. Passes back up to Amante. Fires too far. And Hansen able to come away with it with 20 seconds remaining on the shot clock.
Golden opportunity there for Amante off a beautiful pass from Radigan.
Another infraction.
Referees are going to talk this one over here.
And yeah, not quite sure about the shot clock restarting. I might think maybe in question, Noah, based on the...
Yeah, the shot from Amante was not saved. So I don't believe the shot clock should have restarted. I think you're exactly right, Peter. I think they're going to put it back potentially to... So they're going to change it back to 16 on the shot clock instead of 60. No surprise there, of course. And we see the shot from Amante here again. Look at Radigan drawing 3, and Amante's so wide open, but yeah, just missed the cage.
Yeah.
So not going to be a shot clock reset there. Kelly Amante Hiller now, there's displeasure on the Northwestern sideline, not understanding the call here.
Might not even be the call. It's
the stoppage of play, absolutely, Peter.
I was going to say, as well, 16 only, because by our count, it was at least in the 20s, but nonetheless, with 10... Can Skane fire long range? Goes for the shot. No good with four.
We do have a flag from the backside here. There does look like there's a call from the backside. Skane is down still. And I do think we have a whistle from the backside here as the possession clock was expiring. Again, the referees are going to talk this one over briefly.
They have had a lot of conversations. Talk us through it, Noah.
Well, let's look again. Skane, I mean, there's contact there. Is it enough for a cross check? It's hard to see from that angle for sure. You can see Skane injured. It does look like a cross check to me, if I had to say, Peter.
Yeah.
I think there's enough contact there forcibly to be a cross check, and it does. That's going to be the call. Or there's going to be a call. No, nothing against Skane because Dylan Amante is taking the free position shot. So I'm not sure what the call is here, Peter. I'm not certain at all.
That was an off-camera foul. But nonetheless.
3 seconds potentially.
So with Amante.
And only 3 seconds on the possession clock, Peter. Got to get it off quickly.
Shoots in the net of Santa Maria with a beautiful save for Michigan.
Santa Maria has been huge so far, and all of that hullabaloo for nothing in the end.
Yeah.
As she makes it happen once more. We knew coming into this game, Peter, no matter how the game went stylistically, that Michigan was going to need a huge game from Santa Maria. That was without a doubt, and she has been up to the task and then some so far.
Her sixth save of the afternoon. An absolutely stellar job. Radigan,
that's
going to
be another yellow. And again, Northwestern is just not being careful enough on these transitions. Radigan, at a certain point, you just have to let the player by. And Radigan, the way where she is in position to the player for Michigan, that's Montemurano, who for the second time has been victim of a yellow card foul. Where Radigan is, where Montemurano is, she's just not going to be able to get to that ball. And now Radigan, the third yellow card for Northwestern, Peter. Radigan's second total card, and not that the green card plays into this too much, but more importantly, it means that the next yellow card for Northwestern will be non-releasable already, and we're still in the middle of the second quarter.
Very aggressive play by Northwestern so far, but so aggressive, it's yielded so many yellows, just unexpected. It's not something Northwestern's done much this year, is get so many yellows so early.
Certainly. We saw it a lot more the last couple years, actually, with Northwestern.
Yeah.
In similar positions.
This guided pass. They're able to pick up the pieces. Nonetheless, is Thompson out of Patterson Mill High School. Near side for Garvey. Potential was there for Bean. Passed and go. Near side, the lane is there. Slide up by White. White, staunch defender, as always. Thompson now looking. Shot clock down to 40. Back to X we go. Shot down. That one's going to stick. Jill Smith out of Mercy High School gives Michigan the one-goal lead.
Peter, the key to any player of situation is quick passing. If you keep the ball moving, eventually you can find the hole, find the gap against a six-player defense. Michigan moved the ball around the fan three times in 20 seconds. And when you do that, you're going to find somebody free. It was Jill Smith, and Michigan has once again taken control of this one with about 5 minutes to play in the second quarter.
Michigan 5, Northwestern 4. We'll be back in a flash. It's NCAA Lacrosse on ESPN+. We're back. Michigan 5, Northwestern 4. Northwestern has won 30 straight home games, the second longest active streak in the nation. But right now, Michigan and Jill Smith are having something to say about that.
Yeah, not only that, Peter, Northwestern has never lost a NCAA tournament game at this field at Martin Stadium. But Jill Smith doesn't care about any of that. The lone Michigan native on this Michigan roster, once again, showing what she can do for her hometown team, has come up huge and been a key cog in this fast-moving Michigan offense that has been undaunted by anything Northwestern has thrown at them today. It's been a really impressive showing for Michigan, acting like a team that won the first two meetings, not the one that lost them.
Jill Smith, all Big Ten team member, as well as all Big Ten tournament team player, showing her prowess yet again.
I believe that Madison Taylor got into the circle early there. Good call from the backside, and that's going to give the draw to Michigan. A lot of little mistakes for Northwestern, Peter, across this first half. We've seen it from experienced and inexperienced players alike. Something the Wildcats really have got to clean up sooner than later.
Against Central Michigan, after trailing early against CMU, Jill Smith had 3 of 4 in a row to really break out the scoring sticks for Michigan.
And once again, the Wolverines taking the possession clock all the way down to 50 before they really start to move here.
Michigan outshot CMU 29-15. Santa Maria had 5 saves that entire game. She is already up to 6 here today. Looking to the dodge inside, box and roll instead. 30 seconds remaining. Michigan looks top of the fan. Near side now. Kaylee Dyer would love that goal back that she had taken away a few minutes ago. Looking outside, going low to no avail at 15. Picked up now, back to X. Thompson trying to go top, dodging, and point blank hits the turf with 3, with 2, with 1, and shot clock expiration. Best defensive sequence of the afternoon for the Wildcats.
Well, and even still, Michigan had a great opportunity. I'm not sure how that pass got through to Schwab past the stick of Sam Smith, but it did, and she had a point-blank opportunity, but tried to go low and spiked it a little bit too much in front of Molly La Liberty, who looked like she had it covered anyways. Now the Wildcats taking a bit of a page out of the Wolverines' book. We've seen them slow it down these last couple possessions, Peter.
I think it's a good idea at this point because, again, you're having your defense exhaust the entirety of the shot clock. Unless you have a good shot opportunity like that for Taylor, whistle goes. Quickendall picks up the pieces with 45. Screen to the near side, Hansen. Looking back for Skane, Quickendall keeps it herself. Quickendall keeps it. The righty goes back to Skane. Switches from righty to lefty. Isolation, there's the pick from Koikendal, no avail. Taylor, 3 hops. As Skane is gonna be slow to get up.
Shooting space was the call though. No cross check on Skane. It was the shooting space on Taylor and another free position opportunity for Northwestern. Michigan has done such a good job, Peter, of being aggressive without being overly aggressive. We've seen so many Northwestern opponents this year cross that line into overly aggressive territory, picking up yellow cards. Michigan has rode that line perfectly. It's been Northwestern the over-aggressor so far in this one.
I was just going to say, I'm catching myself often looking for the after-the-whistle off ball because there's been so many infractions that haven't been on the ball handler themselves. Maddie Taylor, the freshman, save again, and a beauty for Santa Maria.
Santa Maria has the Wildcats read like a book, Peter. She's seen this team so much this year now. She knows where they like to go.
Yep.
She's reading every move in advance. Clearly a goalkeeper who's watched a lot of film, who knows her stuff, and right now is making it happen to perfection. She's not the most physically, athletically gifted goalkeeper, but she's really smart in that cage, knows where to go, knows what to do, and has made some key stops in this one. The Wildcats have got to start mixing up their shot selection, have not gone low on her very much at all this game.
Wildcats, 15 shots so far, yielding 4 goals. So right now, Michigan, again, taking a lot of time off the clock before setting up their offense, but it's worked so far. If you limited that possession time and score goals, Smith now dodges back in, bounces, hit the far pipe. Michigan reclaims the possession.
Well, Liberty a bit slow to get up. I do think she might have gotten a piece of that, but she also went down quickly and looked to tweak something, but she's back up and active in the cage again. And again, this might be actually the most impactful tweak of the game so far, was Michigan slowing things down offensively. It's led to a lot of great looks for the Wolverines and put a ton of pressure on the Northwestern defense.
Less than 60 seconds now. Michigan wants to use at least half of that time with their 30 seconds of the shot clock to not allow Northwestern much to play with after they presumably wait to the end of this shot clock to take their shot. Let's see if Northwestern can stand tall again.
Well, Peter, Michigan is undefeated when leading at halftime, and you can bet they know it.
Shot right off of the shoulder pads of La Liberty. Play clock doesn't stop. Michigan now will hold on for one final go. The Michigan faithful on their feet here at Martin Stadium. Up by one. Trying for two. 10 seconds remain. Pass back to X. Near side. Looking for the outlet. Smith fires. Save again by La Liberty. And as time expires, Michigan will go into half leading 5-4 against the Wildcats.
Well, Molly La Liberty trying to inject a little bit of juice into Northwestern. Three massive saves in this final Michigan possession. But Peter, I just mentioned it. The Michigan Wolverines are 0-7 when they trail at the half this year. They are 12-0 when they lead. Hannah Neals and Steve loves to play from in front, and they have worked themselves in front with an inspired first half, trying to become the first team to ever beat the number one seed in the round of 16, Peter.
We're going to take a timeout when we come back. Second half action, Michigan 5, Northwestern 4. It's NCAA second round tournament action on ESPN+.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Second half action about to get underway. The Big Ten champions find themselves trailing 5-4 against the visiting blue of Michigan. Alongside Noah Kaufman, I'm Peter Ferrari. Noah, not only has it been good for Michigan scoring, but defensively, Santa Maria has said stop time and time again.
Yeah, we mentioned how well Santa Maria knows this Northwestern team. She has shown it today. Only allowed the 4 goals, 7 saves for the standout from Ann Arbor. Michigan has been electric defensively. Santa Maria looks like she's looking into the minds of the Wildcat attackers when they're ready to shoot. Northwestern out of sorts in the first half, and Santa Maria a huge part of why. We'll see if she can keep it going in the second half the same way.
A few things to point out, Noah, just in terms of trends, in terms of history. Michigan has trailed against Northwestern both their prior matches. Michigan, every time, as you stated before, going into half, they have never lost when winning at halftime. And the last time that this Northwestern squad has trailed his half was you, me, talking about them against Boston College February the 19th.
Yes,
it's been a few months.
Only 3 months ago, Peter, I was about to say. Northwestern, as you said, has led at halftime in their last 15 games. They are 1-1 only when trailing at halftime. But Sam Smith doesn't care about any of those stats. She's going to keep on winning draws and putting her offense in the best position to succeed. Really impressive run from her despite the scoreboard. It is now 9-3 in the draw control margin for Northwestern. And if you told me before the game, Peter, that Northwestern would be plus 6 on draws and trailing by 1, I might have slapped you because I would not have believed it.
I would then say, ow.
Right.
Nonetheless, Santa Maria, you know, also to call out the prowess she has in the net, also a 3-year letter winner in field hockey and was all-conference her senior season in that sport. Bounce shot to no avail by Radigan. Radigan's one of those players, I don't want to use the word flustered per se, but it's been an up-and-down game for her so far.
Certainly. And, Peter, that was one of the adjustments we expected to see at halftime. Northwestern trying to go low more often. You saw in that highlight package against Santa Maria, they haven't done it too much. And Radigan tried it that time, but spiked it a little too much into the ground.
High shot by Skane. Unsuccessful.
The Wildcats continue to just look a little bit off. They have just been not exactly themselves. And with 34 on the shot clock here, they're getting some decent looks in this possession. But again, Michigan making it hard for them to really get directly in front of the net. And that's what's helped a lot of Santa Maria's success as well, is she's been able to see these shots from farther away. Got to credit the Michigan defense. They've been fantastic against the number 1 offense in the country.
Can Izzy Skane find a goal to tie it up? 20 seconds remaining. Passes far side. Koikendahl, not afraid to play. Pull the trigger from long range. Passes Skane high, no good. Radigan retrieves it. 10-7. Clock is ticking down with 4, with 3. Koikendahl mishandles it, and that will be a rolling shot. Michigan rides it out the entire time. What a defensive opening possession for Blue.
And a really uncharacteristic miss by Izzy Skane. Phenomenal pass. About a 35-foot pass from Aaron Koikendahl. Found her about 8 feet away from goal. And Skane just goes over the top and misses it. And then the charge. Wow. Samantha White putting her body on the line. Second team All-American. Getting in front of Gooch and drawing the charge call. And then got hit from behind there. Trying to clear it for Northwestern.
Talking about Sam White, Coach Veneciano said, Pete, I honestly forget she's a sophomore. Always very, very open to leadership. She is vocal. She has a presence about her. And here's the key. She said, my favorite thing about Sam is she is strong on and off the ball. You saw it right there.
8 turnovers for Michigan, and they're still in the lead, Peter. It is really remarkable the way these stats distinguish themselves from the score.
Rolling around, shooting, scoring, tying it. Al Hansen, bang, the 5'7 grad student. Ties it up at 5.
What have we been saying all day, Peter? The Wildcats need to get to the front of the net, and it's easier said than done, but Elle Hansen here knew the attention was focused elsewhere.
Yeah.
So she makes a quick little fake and then just makes her move to the front of net. She knows if she can get in front, she's not going to see a double because the defense's focus is on her teammates. So she makes her little move, gets in there quickly, and makes it happen. You mentioned that 1B scoring the easiest game, Peter. I think today what's more important is the 2A, the 2B scoring. Who is that second wave of Wildcat attackers that can be effective when the top three or four are neutralized? And Elle Hansen can certainly be that.
Elle Hansen, her 21st goal on the year. We were talking about it earlier in the second quarter, the transition of this Northwestern team. You get an Izzy Skane back from injury. You lose a Gilbert. You lose a Girardi. Who is going to step up to fill in the offensive attack around one Izzy Skane? Great job by Hansen showing her worth there.
And I do want to go back to that Sam White charge that she took. That may be a huge momentum swing. Remember back in the first quarter, Peter, Northwestern had the ball all quarter long.
Yeah.
As this one's still up for grabs and potentially another draw control win. No, it'll go to Michigan instead. Northwestern had the ball all quarter long.
Yeah.
Michigan flipped the script in the second quarter
and
put the pressure on Northwestern's defense. The Wildcats had the ball the entire first 3 minutes of this third quarter. Keep an eye on that possession time. If the Wildcats can really keep the pressure on this Michigan defense, eventually you'd have to think the floodgates will open at least partially.
Talked about the two times they've trailed at half this year. Syracuse, that was their only loss on the season. A one-goal loss, 16-15, in front of 2,000 people against number 5 Syracuse. That was the opening game of the season, Feb 11th. The next time they trailed by one was a victory against number 3 at the time, BC, 15-14. Both of those games, a one-goal difference. All things are lining up for us to have the potentially same outcome here.
The defense has just been superb for Michigan. Can the offense pick up the slack? Because they have not scored now, Peter, in approaching 8 minutes of action. The whistle goes against Northwestern, but really quietly, this Wildcat defense has turned up the heat defensively.
The last two times these teams have matched, it's been the second half scoring of when Jill Smith, who has led the charge not only throughout the whole season, but especially in the second half, has really made her presence known, especially against the Wildcats. So let's see what she's able to do as White slides up to defend. Shot clock down to 10. Back to X. Over the middle. Shot. Goal. Regaining the lead. The crisp passing again by Schwab. Again, Noah back at X. Somebody makes a run. 1-2. Schwab was the third wave of the teammates for Michigan, as you see here. Beautiful job by Schwab.
When the ball is behind the goal with 70 seconds left on the shot clock, Peter, everybody is ready for the cut to the middle.
Yep.
When the ball is behind the goal with 10 seconds left on the shot clock, everybody's tired. They've been defending for 80 seconds. All of a sudden, that cut up the middle is so much more deadly and potential to catch a sleeping defender off guard. That's how long Michigan waited. That's how deep they got it into the shot clock. And that's when Julius Schwab capitalized for another great look and another goal for Michigan.
An up and down season for this Michigan squad. They floated just above 500 before rattling off 3 in a row against Colorado, Ohio State, and Cincinnati. They lost to Northwestern, but then got 3 more in a row against Eastern Michigan, Rutgers, and Xavier. The rest of the time, back and forth between wins and losses. So not the typical season that one may expect, but nonetheless, Maddie Taylor comes away with it. Northwestern trailing by 1, and they regain possession.
Taylor, impressive to run all the way into the attacking end without getting it taken away. I think she was almost trying to draw a potential yellow card challenge for Michigan there. But clears it without issue.
Now let's see, with Koikendall in possession, how much of the time Northwestern wants to take off of this shot clock. We saw Michigan in the second quarter. We've talked about it time and time again. Their strategy changed to be that of, okay, well, we're just going to take as much of the shot clock as we can and try to get some clear shots off at the end. It's worked more than once. Amante on the ground. She gets back up. Skane double-teamed all the way back out past the fan. What a defensive stand thus far by Michigan yet again.
A lot of holding the ball for Northwestern in the late shot clock here. Not a lot of passes. And unable to save that one on the back end.
That was a misguided pass. Amante can't run it down. Michigan now. Smith Looks for the one-time pass. White running it down. White scoops it up. On the ground is White. Whistle, cross check. Point and possession going to Northwestern. La Liberty challenged right off the go from behind.
And La Liberty looked like she was fouled a couple times there. Aggressive from Kaylee Thompson. Eventually able to get the ball away.
Pass up ahead to Jane Hansen. And she now subs out.
Northwestern is so focused right now, Peter, on trying to get the right matchup offensively. We saw a lot more stagnancy down the stretch of the last possession. They were moving it early and then slowed it down a lot, trying to get one-on-one looks. Didn't work out that time.
Back over the middle, point blank, and Amante misses. Collision down low.
And Skane yellow. Is going to be sent to the sideline for a non-releasable yellow again. Northwestern too aggressive on the back end, Peter. And Dylan Amante, for the second time in this game, has missed an absolute point-blank shot. And then Skane, just no reason at all to try to go through the back there. It's only ever going to be yellow. I don't know what she's thinking. And this is a non-releasable two-minute foul. And now Skane, Koikendahl, Radigan all have a yellow and all need to be careful in transition trying to slow down Michigan.
Uncharacteristic can be such a, I guess you could say, cliche, but right now this is as uncharacteristic of a Northwestern squad that we have seen all season.
And Michigan, you have to give them credit. The Wolverines have taken Northwestern out of their game. They've taken them off their rhythm. They have put the game in their own hands and played the way they want to play. And that's resulted in this 6-5 lead and a chance, a real chance to add here.
Jill Smith, the best scorers in all of NCAA lacrosse, calls for it. Open in the middle, late slide. Zone defense, of course, right now for the Cats. Sam White presses off on Bean. Back to X. That's been one of the great positions so far for Marquette, is that X pass right up to those streaking teammate. Getting in the lane. Oh, just reading the eyes. Great job by number 6, Allie Berkery.
Well, Peter, Michigan has taken a page out of Northwestern's book today in the roving defender, right? Moving that defender around on the back line and making things hard with that secondary defender. Northwestern getting back to what they do best with Allie Berkery moving around back there and making something happen defensively to cause a turnover and create a huge change of possession here for the Wildcats. They can ride out the penalty if they wish. They can get to attacking 6-on-7 if they wish. A lot more of a comfortable position for Northwestern now than it was even just a few seconds ago.
It does look like they're going to ride out this final 25 seconds.
Well, one of the problems is the player who's on the yellow card is your best offensive player.
Sure. Maybe if the situation was different, if it was a different player riding out the yellow, they may try to be on the offensive. But once Gain comes back in, just had a conversation with the coaching staff while the shot clock expires with 3, with 2, with 1. Northwestern back to full strength. The Wildcat faithful here at Martin Stadium getting loud as Northwestern trails by 1, 5:40 remaining in the third. Misguided pass in the middle. Taylor trying to pick up the piece, is able to do so. Maddie Taylor, the freshman, what a season she has had. She rolls around, looks for the outlet pass, can't find it, fires. That's wide to the right. And Michigan comes away with it.
Yeah, not much for Taylor there. She had to get a shot off late in the clock. She didn't have a great angle, but she had to do it anyways, and it just didn't work. But again, Michigan has limited every opportunity Northwestern has tried to have. But another careless pass for Michigan. They've now turned it over for the 10th time, Peter.
Yep.
And at a certain point, they're going to stop getting away with these.
Skane gets the whistle called in her favor as Koikendahl now sets up the Wildcat attack. 4:48. Michigan leads by 1. For Noah Kaufman, I'm Peter Ferrari. Second round action on ESPN+. Multiple yellows across the board for Northwestern. non-releasable penalties for the rest of the way. Getting the pick, Taylor. She's right inside. It goes too far to the right. Short range shots, not finding the back of the cage.
The confidence just looks shaken for the Wildcats right now. Part of it has to be Santa Maria playing a great game in goal. But right now, these Wildcats are getting the looks they want, and they're just not converting. Taylor and Amonte, in particular, have really struggled there. And a whistle against Michigan here to give Kuykendall a little bit of free space to operate in.
And some of them aren't even close. That's the other thing, though. It's not like they're... Oh, there's the close-range shot by Taylor. They're waving it off. They are waving it off and calling a yellow on Maddie Taylor.
Yeah, it's got to be follow-through, Peter. Yep. I didn't see it live, but... We saw a very similar call go against Michigan in the first half on a goal. We saw a follow-through called, and Taylor's going to be sent to the side with her first yellow, the fifth for Northwestern. Take a look at the finish. Yep, right on the head. That's an easy one, Peter. You have to call it there based on the way the rule is written. That is a guaranteed dangerous follow-through. You can see the contact directly to the head on the follow-through. It's going to be called every time, and it takes a goal off the board for Northwestern when they really had to have one.
Both teams have been... charged with a yellow on a follow through, but again, this time around though, Noah, unreleasable 2 minutes for Northwestern. It'd be different if they were tied. It'd be different if they were up one, but still in the hole by one. You just have to, you feel that they're pressing so very hard right now.
One stat I really want to call your attention
Please
to, Peter,
do.
That I think tells a lot of the story of this game. Right now, Northwestern has committed 5 yellow card fouls and a green card foul. Michigan has committed 1 yellow card foul. Michigan has 19 other fouls, and Northwestern only has 2. Michigan's aggression has been so much more carefully considered than Northwestern's has. Every time the Wildcats have committed a foul, just about, it's been a card. Michigan has been much more careful about when they commit their fouls, what kinds of fouls they commit, and they're going to get a free position chance here, only their third of the game on the shooting space against Samantha White.
Free position for Bean. Look for her to make that pass over the middle. Northwestern readjusts defensively. Tough play nonetheless. Passing back out. Michigan deciding just to ride out more of this shot clock. You know, we discussed with Coach Venichanos yesterday, okay, what's going to be the halftime adjustment? And she goes, well, Michigan always makes us make an adjustment. Not an aggressive follow-through there as two players are on the ground right now.
Well, it was a phenomenal save by Molly La Liberty. Regardless of what the call is here, La Liberty makes a tremendous stop right on the doorstep, takes it away, her sixth save of the game, and a great one. And now the finger pointing begins.
A yellow card. We have a yellow card issue. I do not know on who, however.
Well, I'm not sure who the foul is on there. I mean, on that look, it looks like the Northwestern defender takes away the footing from Michigan. Yeah, I mean, that's a foul, it looks to me, on Northwestern. But the yellow card is going against Michigan.
Yeah, it looks like Carolyn Bean's going to be called for the yellow.
Yeah, so I guess they get her on follow through. I don't know. For me there, it's always tough, Peter. This is such a difficult call. There's a lot of moving bodies here. But Kendall Halpern is getting into Bean. As Bean follows through, it does look like the follow-through is dangerous on that second look we saw, but it's a call dangerous follow-through, so now we've got two players sitting on the sideline on dangerous follow-through penalties. Only one of them wiped out a goal, but Northwestern a chance to get into a 6-on-6 situation on offense. And if they go here, they could go 6-on-6, or they could wait 45 seconds and have a window with a player advantage.
So, as stated, 30 seconds plus for Northwestern to be able to then have 60 seconds to do with as much as they can. However, only 50 seconds on the shot clock. I was told there'd be no math, but nonetheless.
I don't know who told you that, but they probably were not talking about lacrosse because we got math all the time in here.
Kuykendall dodges outside to inside, so they have to be mindful. Beautiful save. Santa Maria, then ground ball on the ground, picked back up, and they are giving that after a foul. Kuykendall slow to get up. Northwestern penalty released, but they still trail by one.
Peter, this game is so physical right now, and that is going to result in a lot of consternation about every whistle both ways. I think the officials have done a great job, especially in this second half, of trying to control this game as it's gotten more physical, trying to slow things down, and we've got a called timeout. I'm not surprised to see it with the way this game is starting to get into a place that really, especially Northwestern and Michigan, both do not really want it to be in. So the Wolverines take a timeout.
Timeout. We'll take it with them. Michigan still leads Northwestern, the number one team in the nation, 6-5. It's second round action on ESPN+. Six to five, your score. Michigan leads Northwestern at Martin Stadium. Beautiful Lake Michigan in the background. And Noah Kaufman next to me. I'm Peter Ferrari. Noah, we're going to take a look again at Maddie Taylor. What an up and down game she's had. But that goal called off on that follow through from a high, high camera angle kind of shows it there. Got to make that call.
Yeah, it looked like a pretty clear call there. And we had the dangerous follow through the other way. But every call in this sort of game, Peter, in the postseason, in a close game that people didn't really expect to be this close, is going to be looked at under a microscope. I think the officials have done a great job in this third quarter of keeping the game playable with the aggression we've seen from both teams, understandable aggression we've seen from both teams. The officials have kept control of this one, kept it under control, and Michigan coming out of the timeout has a chance to really make things happen. I think the main talking point from Coach Hannah Nielsen in that timeout, Peter, slow it down again, right? They were starting to get a little bit faster than they wanted to be. Let's take all the time out of this quarter, not give Northwestern a chance to answer, get into the fourth quarter with the lead at the very least, and see what we can do on the back end after that.
Also to note, offensively, Izzy Skane, 81 goals coming into today, one out of the five so far here today. They have stopped this game train.
Nine shots, Peter. She's taking her shots, but she's taking them not from the places she wants to take them. She's trying to shoot over three people. She's trying to shoot on the run from outside the fan. She's not taking the kind of look she wants to take, and that's what's allowed Michigan to really keep her under control.
45 seconds on the game clock, 20 seconds on the shot clock. Michigan has been successful offensively with that quick pass in. Take it away by Northwestern on the ground. So with 30 seconds left, Northwestern has to push through this ride very quickly. White, three on one, she loses possession, she keeps the whistle. But with every whistle, it slows down the attempt for the Wildcats. With just over 15 seconds, can they get a shot off? They have it over in Skane.
And Michigan is offsides here, I believe. Yeah, I'm not sure what Jill Smith was thinking. She stopped like she was going to stay out. I think she knew she was going to be one too many defenders and then ran in anyways for the offsides. That stops the clock and gives Northwestern a chance to gather themselves.
Skane, does she have the equalizer? With five, with four, with three. Skane fires, no good. Radigan on the spot, goes wide, and to no avail. And still, Michigan leads by a slim one-goal lead, 6-5 as we head into the fourth. Noah, what a game so far for Michigan.
Yeah, the Wolverines have done everything right. They've limited every aspect of the Wildcat offense the best way they can. Northwestern is 0-6 on free position shots. Skane is 1-10 on her shot attempts. The Michigan Wolverines have even turned over the Wildcats 8 times. They've done enough in every respect to keep Northwestern at bay. Do they have enough to do it for 15 more minutes? We're going to have to find out after this, Peter.
We will. Michigan 6, Northwestern 5. It's NCAA Lacrosse on ESPN+. With beautiful Lake Michigan in the background, 6-5 your score. Northwestern was leading 3-2 after the first quarter, Noah. They only scored one goal apiece in the second and third, as uncharacteristic as a game for the Wildcats, but that's in big part to Michigan doing everything right.
And Michigan has slowed it down, Peter, but it's not just that. Northwestern has still gotten 28 shots off. The Wildcats are not a team that scores 5 goals on 28 shots, but Michigan has made all their shots difficult. Santa Maria has made 9 really good saves. The Wolverines have limited everything defensively, even while losing the turnover battle and losing the draw control battle. The only question is, can they do it for 15 more minutes? It's been the perfect first 45 for the Wolverines, but another draw control win for Northwestern. 11-4 now for the Wildcats, Peter. It's honestly kept them in this game.
Yeah. Northwestern has not scored less than 13 goals in a game this season. Not sure if they're going to find 8 here in the fourth. But regardless of the outcome, Michigan has played the best game, they may say, of the season. And we may as well. Kuykendall, point blank, tying it up. Erin Kuykendall, she started the game with a goal in the first 45 seconds. Does the same here in the fourth. Cats tie it at 6.
For Erin Kuykendall, everybody talks about the big moves, the big fakes. On this play, it was the little fakes. She made a little pass fake to the middle. She made a little pass fake to the outside. And all of a sudden, she's by her defender, by another defender. And when she gets in close, she does not miss. Erin Kuykendall makes it happen with calmness, with her presence, with her maturity. And that is a huge goal to even things here for Northwestern right out of the gates.
Both coaches yesterday were very candid, and I appreciate that, and to both staffs for allowing those conversations to happen. Both teams mentioned what happened against North Carolina. Northwestern and Coach Veneciano said, Peter, we cannot dwell on the past, but we have to accept what happened and move on and learn from it. That's why we cannot let that happen again in a game we were leading. They weren't leading this one by but more than a goal, but nonetheless, on the flip side, Michigan even referenced that game and said this team can be beat.
Alternating possession there as the ball did not clear on the draw, so this time it goes to Michigan. Michigan has won 2 out of their 5 draws, Peter, on the alternating possession, but they all count the same in the book.
As you might have heard in the background, Kuykendall's 50th goal of the season, the only multi-goal score right now for Northwestern. Michigan, with no man-up advantage, still taking their time to let this clock matriculate.
And, Peter, it's not just to bleed time against a fantastic offense, although it's partially that. It's because Michigan has gotten their best looks late in the clock.
Sure.
It's been happening all game. And I think they've recognized that, right? That's been a key for them.
Inside shot. La Liberty knocks it down, picked up off the ground by Jane Hansen.
La Liberty has very calmly made a couple of massive saves in the last couple of quarters. She started out the game a little bit slowly. She's faced very difficult close-range shots all game, and still she's now up to 6 saves on 12 shots on goal. Been phenomenal for Northwestern in the cage once again, even though we haven't called her name as much.
I've spoken to Coach Venichanos throughout the season from the get-go till yesterday, and I said, Coach, talk me through the growth of La Liberty. Talk me through the transfer from Tufts, playing outstanding from the get-go all the way to now. She said, Peter, all credit goes to her. She was excited for the challenge to make the jump, never satisfied mentally, physically, and spiritually.
And Radigan is fouled there on the cross check. The other transfer.
Looks like going to be a free position now for Radigan. To note, Radigan has taken off the all-white hoodie. Not sure if that was maybe impeding.
Oh, yeah, it did look like, yeah, not a cross check call. You're absolutely right, Peter.
Radigan, low shot. Oh, my goodness. Hot cheese off to the right pipe. Northwestern regains the lead 7-6.
We've talked about Northwestern's top stars being out of sorts at times in this game, Peter. Radigan and Koikendall have come into the fourth quarter and shifted that narrative. Look at the move to get to her left hand around the defender. Starting on the right side to get around to the left like that with that much ease is incredible, and then just scoops it low, her favorite shot, and puts it away. Beautiful to the stick side. Just beat Santa Maria, and all of a sudden this game has a very different complexion.
Well, you know, again, trailing by 2, they going into the fourth. They now lead by 1, just 3 minutes or so into this fourth quarter. To quote the great Apollo Creed from Rocky, there is no tomorrow for either of these teams. Now, it's also a game of momentum, Noah. You and I know this for all the years we've called this beautiful sport together. Momentum seems to be shifting back to Northwestern. Michigan and the shot clock killing that they've done so far offensively gets a draw control, one of the rare draw controls they've had all year. Now trailing, do they use the same mentality?
I think if I'm Michigan, I do, but oh, Skane thought she had it clean, but I do think she got the arm of Jill Smith. It looked like a good call from up here. On a massive draw control from Maddie Burns, and then Michigan turning it into a possession. If I'm the Wolverines, I keep it slow, Peter. It's been working all game. Even though it hasn't been phenomenal, you've got to stay with what's been effective. They've been the most effective when they've taken their time and gotten the good looks. I do think the ball has to get behind the net into that X position more this possession than it did the last two.
And there's, you know, pluses and minuses right now to the strategy. It's gotten you this far in the game. Misguided pass over the middle. That's been successful for them all game. Noah, X to the streaking teammate off the middle. Nobody ran.
It was a classic miscommunication there. Burke was open, but I don't think she knew she was open, and the pass came to the spot she would have gone to. She didn't go, so it becomes a turnover. Just a little miscommunication by Michigan can create such a huge difference in the game. And you're right, Peter, it works. It's been working all game. It could have worked again, but it wasn't quite there this time.
Well, and that's one thing I was going to say. The only detriment to taking so much time out of the shot clock is if it doesn't yield positive results, it's okay or satisfactory if you're winning. But now trailing, that just gives more time. Koikendall draws on the ground, flicks it from her wrist, and that's going to just go possession Michigan. I thought there might have been contact, but no whistle called. As Koikendall gets back up.
Well, there was contact, Peter, but I think it's a good no call. Koikendall was not impeded. She lost her footing a little bit. I don't think there's a foul there. Skane goes to ground. I don't think she was fouled either. I think it's a good no call at this juncture of the game. Let the players decide it, and it goes over to Michigan.
Again.
Oh, that's so swipe. Clean.
Woo! Clean swipe from behind for the Cats. Up to Koikendall, to Skane. Skane, isolated, over, point blank. Oh, Skane can't hold on to the possession. Maybe one too many passes. ground shot in. Number 29, Carly Mahoney. Unbelievable Northwestern on a 3-0 run for Carly Mahoney. Her goal, first goal of the season for Mahoney. Noah, my goodness.
Molly La Liberty comes all the way down to celebrate this one with Northwestern, and you can understand why. This is the play of the game. A phenomenal takeaway from Jane Hansen. One of the best plays she's made all year to take that ball away and start the break. And then it is one too many passes from Skane, but Carly Mahoney gets it back, and she doesn't care how many goals she scored. She doesn't care that she's a defender. She gets in there, she gets her chance, and she rips it past Santa Maria. Momentum has firmly flipped. Timeout on the field for Michigan, and what a sequence from Jane Hansen on one end to Carly Mahoney on the other.
Let's keep it here right now. No, looking at this situation, it's not just Northwestern having the lead right now. It's that they have gained the lead from Michigan. Again, a three-run scoring rally right now for Northwestern. Let's go through Michigan right now. If you are Michigan, what's the conversation in the huddle?
Well, the conversation is different from what they need to do. The conversation is, we are fine. We need to stay calm. We need to stay under control. We're losing our control a little bit. We need to keep our focus where it needs to be and stay calm and make a play. What needs to happen is Jill Smith needs to start to take over. Northwestern is taking you away a little bit more on defense. Things are going to get more sped up down the stretch of this game. It's natural. That's what happens. Jill Smith has to step into the star role that she's inhabited all year and make some plays one-on-one, because I don't think Michigan is going to find a lot of open chances otherwise.
Carly Mahoney. Now you know, if those have watched at home, saw her reaction. She literally dropped her stick out of her left hand and looked around like, what was that? I don't know what that is. That's a goal, Mahoney, in the second round of the NCAA tournament. There's no easier way to say goal of her career.
Absolutely. For Carly Mahoney, the veteran defender, too. The yellow card at the start of this game, not her best start, but she's been excellent defensively in the second half. Makes a huge play in transition right there when Northwestern needed it. And now the Wildcats can really bring their draw control advantage to bear here. Michigan has won the last two, one in an alternating possession. But if Sam White can get back in the win column against Gooch, Northwestern can start to really get this game to where they want it to be.
To note, when these two teams played 18-11 the final just a week ago, the fourth quarter had a 5-goal run between Smith, 2 by Taylor, Radigan, and Skane to close things out before 1 by Smith at the end. Like you said already, Noah, it's the tie. It needs to be the Smith show for the rest of the time here today.
And Gooch had it there, Peter, but she stepped out of bounds. She was so close to coming away clean with that draw control, but couldn't control her feet. And then a turnover right back for Michigan. Huge play.
Again, Carly Mahoney, what a treasured moment at a Wes Morris High School. At the top now, number 22, Montemorano out of Bethesda, Maryland. Back to X. This has been the strength so far of Michigan. There it goes to Smith, off to the right. They're still they're still keeping their strategy that's got them this far along, Noah, in taking a lot of time out of the shot clock, trying to find that good shot, trying to wear down the defense of Northwestern. To the left, side shot, no good, hitting the ground. As Smith thought she might have gotten hit in the face, no call, shot clock at 15. Back to X, looking for the outlet pass. Oh, mishandle on the pass. Montemorano, are they gonna restart the shot clock, Noah?
Whistle from the backside here. I'm not sure where we got that whistle. Mahoney had a great play to take away the ball after the initial pass, but they've brought it back, it looks like, for a free position chance for Michigan. Really interested to see this replay here. Montemurano had the pass, looking to shoot. Ball was stripped out of her cross. Looked like Mahoney made that play, but a foul.
I believe it was another off-camera foul. They at one point pointed to Gillespie.
Well, let's take another look here. Mahoney is there, takes it away. Yeah, I'm not seeing it there. I don't know what it was unless Halpern covered it with her stick. I didn't see it there.
Free position, 7 seconds. Michigan trails by 2, 8:26 in the game. Losing it, running in on the free position. Ground ball up in the air, dangerous position. Shot clock expires. Northwestern up by 2 and gets a much needed possession.
Northwestern got a timeout right before that foul there, so there won't be any card or anything like that. But Mahoney picks it up off the ground ball. A big mistake for Montemurano, Peter. She was gifted a huge chance there to make it happen with the ground ball, with the free position shot. Instead, she loses it on her way in, and Northwestern takes a timeout, knowing Kelly Monty Hiller is that she can make this a huge lead at 3 goals. Peter, if you think about it, right, most lacrosse games that Northwestern finds themselves in, 3-goal lead, not that much. They're scoring back and forth all day.
Yeah.
In this game, the way Michigan is attacked offensively, 3 goals would be a massive hurdle for the Wolverines to jump. You better believe that Kelly Monty-Hiller and her staff know that. They call timeout to slow things down, give Northwestern a chance to secure possession and create something offensively in what could be a turning point possession all the way for Northwestern.
One thing that I want to, that I think bears mentioning, when having a conversation with the coaching staff, what did you learn from your loss last year against North Carolina? This is what they said. It's focus. We need our leaders to step up, not just at the end, not just to close out games, but at different points of the game, we need our leaders to step up, whether it's a meeting, whether it's practice. She said, Pete, as the coaching staff, we just hope it sticks.
And what have we seen, Peter? The 4 biggest plays of this quarter have been seniors or grad students, right? Yep. First, it was Aaron Koikendall with the calm goal. Then it was Haley Radigan making something happen with the goal. Then it was the massive takeaway by Jane Hansen. And then Carly Mahoney puts it away on the other end. All seniors or grad students, all making crucial, calm plays in key moments for Northwestern. That's been the story of this fourth quarter turnaround so far.
And Carly Mahoney had 7 shots against Central Michigan as a career high. That was over a year ago.
And that was in the game that Northwestern won in the first round of the NCAA tournament 22-7 last year.
So, and that is just an outstanding story. Team captain also was the Heart and Hustle Award winner in high school, all county, all league, first team, all senior, sectional champ, academic honor roll. I'm sure Scott and Pam are at home or here in the stands smiling from ear to ear.
I would guess you're in the stands, but the smiles are there no matter what. I would agree. And look again, it's Hansen one more time, just creating a very easy clear. Jane Hansen making it happen.
Another note I want to throw out. Noah, you ready for this? Mahoney, her 2 final choices of where to attend college, 2 teams playing in front of you today at Martin Stadium.
Very interesting.
Between Michigan and Northwestern. Shout out to our research department for those outstanding news and notes.
Skane with a lot of space coming in here. That double came a little bit later. And it was the attention that Skane commands that created the shooting space there. Skane drew that late double because she was starting to make her move. Quick pass to Amonte, quick pass to Radigan. Radigan gets the free position chance because Michigan's defense was sliding late. It's all about Izzy Skane and the on-ball attention she commands for Northwestern.
Most important save, potentially. That actually rolls out of the stick. A rare mistake. A little bit of rain coming down now, Noah. Just a slight rain, but maybe starting to affect the players a bit. Slick stick, slick ground.
Aaron Garvey with a huge cause turnover there for Michigan. I think she got in there more than the rain did, Peter. But either way, a play Michigan had to have, and they have it. And now another chance, their 3rd, to cut this lead to 1. This could be the turning point back the other way with under 7 minutes to play now.
when speaking with the coaches, I said, does the impeding weather have any potential changes? And they said, well, we're not even going to think about it right now because it's not supposed to rain at the beginning. If it comes, it comes. So ever so slightly right now in the background, 40 seconds on the shot clock. Nearing a point of absolute need for Michigan, as I believe White's going to be called with the infraction.
Yep, she impeded the movement there. That was a clear one for White, who couldn't quite get the body in front and reached out with the stick instead. And it's not a good angle for Davis, but passing opportunities from the free position arc abound, even with the shot clock limited.
Taken away by the Wildcats, streaking ahead. Number 4, Jane Hansen. Not the first time she's done that today, Noah. Passing, Skein loses possession on the ground. Can Taylor pick it up? She can. Strong defense as Amante now resets up the attack for Northwestern. My goodness, another close opportunity missed, but at least on this time, if you're a fan of Northwestern, you're doing so with a 2-goal lead.
Yeah, and Skate, I think, never fully had that one. Went to shoot without the ball and across. But either way, another phenomenal play by Jane Hansen, the unsung hero today, to be sure. And that's more great defense for Michigan. A good no call. There's nothing there. Radigan's trying to drive into three defenders, and that's just not going to work out for you too often, even when you are one of the top goal scorers in NCAA lacrosse history. And that time, Michigan stayed home, stayed calm, and made the play, turned it over.
Now,
Radigan forcing the issue a bit too much there, Peter.
Now is the time. If you are a fan of Michigan, if you are a player, a coach, the time is now. You have had a very long scoreless drought. You had the lead 6-5 coming into the fourth. You have not scored in the entirety of the fourth quarter.
Just a reminder for game reset purposes, Michigan is out of timeouts. Northwestern has one remaining, just so everybody's aware.
Our side, setting back up is Smith at the fan. Passes it down low, goal! Within one, number 31, Julia Schwab out of Dobbs Ferry, New York, brings the Wolverines to within one, 8-7.
Schwab's second goal, she's done it in opposite ways. Her first one was slicing up the middle of the field on the pass from the X. This time, face cut across the middle, gets the pass from Smith. Again, Northwestern focused in on Smith. They don't see Schwab coming, and a massive goal when it looked like Michigan was on the verge of going down three. They cut it to one instead.
We'll take a quick timeout. Northwestern 8, Michigan 7. It's NCAA second round lacrosse action on ESPN+.
Welcome back, 8-7 your score. Noah, the bracket, my goodness, it's gonna get interesting. But looking ahead now to what's happening, Michigan gets the draw control.
There will be time for brackets later, Peter. We gotta watch some lacrosse right now.
the season.
And a massive draw control win. I feel like I'm using my word too much. But this game has been so close all the way through, Peter. Everything feels so big, especially in a game where so few goals have been scored. And Michigan with another chance here. It was only a minute or so ago that the Wildcats were on the doorstep to make it a three-goal lead. And now Michigan could tie it right here.
Every possession now so, so crucial in a one-goal game. Michigan trailed 8-6 after a three-goal run by the Wildcats, all here in the fourth. If you've missed the whole game but the fourth, my goodness, if you've gotten a treat this early afternoon in Evanston. Strong defense by Northwestern. 25 remaining. We've been in this position before where we have seen Michigan go to the bitter end. On the ground, Sam White, the sophomore. Huge turnover with time nearing expiration of the shot clock.
That time the help defense was very timely for Northwestern. Garvey penetrated. Smith and Mahoney were there immediately. Triple teamed. Garvey had it taken away just like that. And it looks like we're going to have a timeout from Northwestern here. Their final timeout.
Sure.
They call it with 3:06 to go. And Peter, you have to know if you're Northwestern here, a goal could very nearly put this one away.
Yeah, let's keep it here this time, Noah. So let's talk about the what-if scenarios and the potentials of the brackets. So looking now, either of these teams, if they come out victorious, they will face the winner of a team that is just about to start right now. So let's take a look at that bracket right now. Again, for Noah Kaufman, I'm Pete Ferrari with Noah's bracketology, I guess you could say.
Well, the bracketology is usually before the bracket comes out, but we look at the bracket as it is right now. Stony Brook and Loyola Maryland will begin very shortly. That start time is about 2 minutes away on ESPN Plus from Baltimore, Maryland. The winner of that one, which should be a really good game between Loyola Maryland and Stony Brook, two of the best teams in the country. The winner of that one gets the winner of this one. If Northwestern wins, that game will be here in Evanston on May 18th. But Michigan could still find a way to pull it out. And that game, of course, will be for a trip to the national semifinals, a place Northwestern has been each of the last 2 years. Remember, Peter, we mentioned this at the top of the broadcast. Yeah. Northwestern, the one seed in the nation for the fifth time in program history. The first four times they won the national championship in a much more precarious position right now than I'm sure they expect it to be, but still a chance to close this game out with just 3:06 to go.
Well, one thing to mention is Northwestern, of course, has not lost since the opening game of the season. Maybe, just maybe, if they come out victorious, they could say, look, we lost the first half of that game. We lost the first three quarters of this game against Michigan. Thankfully, won that fourth and pivotal quarter, and that can be the motivation, the catalyst for the rest of the tournament.
And it would be Northwestern's first win this season after trailing after three quarters. Could be a big thing for them to point to. But right now, can the offense get back in rhythm? They were moving so cleanly for that start of the fourth quarter, but then little mistakes from Skain, from Radigan, have prevented further goals from scoring. And right now, Emerson Bolig really being harried on this clear. Michigan going back to that early game strategy we saw of putting a lot of pressure on that restraining line. Yeah. But Northwestern finally able to get it across.
With 55 seconds remaining on the shot clock. So twofold for your Northwestern Wildcats. One, can you take away enough of the shot clock to limit the opportunities for Michigan? Two, can you find a clean shot to potentially regain possession?
And I think the focus has to be on the second. It has to be, Peter, can we get a goal here more than can we work the clock too deep? You got to try to score first and foremost and put this game to a two-goal deficit for Michigan.
To 10 remaining in game time, down to 20 seconds. Maddie Taylor inside, falling, going away, but that will leave 15 seconds to try to get another shot off or reset the shot clock. Koikendahl, far side, Amanti, streaking. Koikendahl, point blank, Santa Maria says thank you, next. Taken away by the Cats. Up at the top, Hansen, over to Amanti with the full reset of the shot clock. Noah, oh my goodness, that was option three. Take a shot, miss, and just regain possession.
And now if you're Northwestern, and the Hillers yelling this on the side, take your time, pass it around, work the clock all the way down. Scoring should not be the focus anymore. After Santa Maria's first save of the fourth quarter and her biggest save of the game, the giveaway for Michigan. might have cost them this one, Peter.
After a magnificent save by Santa Maria, it just matriculated to a teammate. Oh, from behind. Taylor gonna get slowly up from the ground.
Wow, that did not necessarily look like a foul to me in live action. We've seen Taylor go down quite a few times today. She went down on her last shot, actually, with limited contact and missed it wide. This time she goes down, gets the whistle, and a key one to prevent the Michigan turnover. Let's take another look here. I guess there's a little push from the inside. We can't see how much contact there is from this angle. Up top, certainly clean. But Taylor gets the whistle she needed, and she'll probably back this one out.
Passing back up to Koikendahl again just to utilize as much of that shot clock in the remaining 45 seconds as possible. So just about a 15-second differential, Noah. If anything, you don't even have to get off the cleanest shots. Take it to zero, fire it. You leave them with 15 seconds. Retreat everybody as fast as you can.
Peter, I'll go even further than that. Take it to zero and throw it into Lake Michigan. 15 seconds is a very limited amount of time to try to go coast to coast for Michigan. Wildcats have to focus on the clock first and foremost at this point.
Down to 15 seconds. Bolig to Koikendahl. Koikendahl passing in, hitting the ground. Going to go back to Santa Maria. They're going to have 20 seconds.
And I didn't believe there was a timeout. Well, Michigan has called a timeout here. I had thought they were out, but it looks like we have a timeout.
Okay, Michigan calls.
And now there's questions being asked here, but Michigan has called the timeout after regaining possession. We had thought they were out, but they had one left, and with 20 seconds left, Michigan's going to get the chance to set up a coast-to-coast opportunity here, Peter.
So it takes a lot, of course, to execute an effective coast-to-coast. If you are Michigan right now, Noah, what is the strategy? Are you going far to near? Are you trying to go down the seam? What's the outlet that you're looking for?
I think what you have to do is not worry too much about getting the perfect pass,
okay,
and try to move it as quickly as possible. Because if you take a couple extra seconds deliberating, all of a sudden you get it over the restraining line with only 4 seconds to go, then your options are so much more limited. You have to get it ahead with a chance to make a move and shoot. For Northwestern, I want to keep my pressure up, right?
Okay.
You can
okay.
foul. You can foul hard if you want to. I'm not advocating going for a yellow card, but fouls are not your concern at this point.
Yeah.
You want to put pressure on Michigan at all times. If you pick up a foul, you pick up a foul. Keep the pressure hard. Make every pass and movement difficult and try to keep them from even getting it close to that restraining line.
3 seconds have been added back onto the clock. 22 seconds, my goodness, what a thrilling end we're about to have to this contest. For Noah Kaufman, I'm Peter Ferrari. While we have a moment, we want to thank all the fans in attendance at Martin Stadium, just showing the beautiful growth of this game, NCAA Women's Lacrosse. Noah, there's nothing like it.
Absolutely, this crowd has been phenomenal. The Northwestern crowds here in Evanston have been phenomenal all year. And wow, the energy, even for a game that has been so gritty and so back and forth, has been absolutely unmatched. Can't say enough about this game and this crowd and this sport.
A Big Ten matchup. Round three coming to a pivotal conclusion. 22 seconds remain. To the far side. Across the middle. 15 seconds. Swatted from behind. Sam White. Knocked down from behind, as Sam White says, I can buy myself flowers. With 8 seconds remain, White getting hugged by all her teammates. Yellow card issued against Michigan. That should just about do it, Noah.
Yeah, it's over, and Sam White does it again. Northwestern had let Michigan a little bit of free rein as they approached midfield, but White was lurking, knowing that pass was going to come up the gut, makes the play happen from behind, takes the contact, doesn't phase her. Incredible stuff from the sophomore, showing again why she's an All-American, making the play to seal this one for Northwestern.
Over to Koikendahl. Koikendahl just running away from all the Wolverines with three, with two, with one. That's going to be it. That's going to be all she wrote. The Northwestern Wildcats come from behind and win 8-7 in as thrilling of a second round victory as you are going to see. These teams celebrating, my goodness, for Michigan, there's nothing you can say. What a game they played.
Well, they played exactly to the layout that Hannah Nielsen wanted to. She did everything right. They did everything right. Just couldn't finish it in those last 15 minutes. That 1-3 goal spurt for Northwestern was too much. But what a gritty, nonstop effort from Michigan. Such an impressive performance for a team that was turning around 48 hours after playing Central Michigan. Gave it everything they had. Left it all on the line. And made this game a nail biter all the way to the finish. What a contest.
Talked about Northwestern trailing into the fourth quarter, then less than 60 seconds into the fourth, found the equalizer, kept going ahead, eked out a win 8-7.
One thing we haven't talked about, Peter, the Wildcat defense allowed just 2 goals in the second half. They were phenomenal. Mahoney and especially Jane Hansen stepped into a massive role defensively, making play after play down the stretch and getting what Northwestern needed to get to find a way to come away with the win. As we take a look at that bracket with Northwestern advancing, Iowa Maryland game just underway. They've taken the early lead against Stony Brook. They await, Northwestern does, the winner of that Loyola Maryland-Stony Brook game. That game will be here in Evanston on May 18th.
I know what you and I will be watching in just a few days from now, Noah. I want to take this opportunity to thank all the staff and crew here throughout the production. Rhett, Casey, Quinn, all the camera operators as part of this ESPN Plus production. On behalf of my broadcast colleague, Noah, it's been a pleasure to call an entire season of lacrosse with you once again, as we will await the winner of Loyola and Stony Brook, who will be taking on Northwestern as the Wildcats defeat the Wolverines third time this year, 8-7 in a thrilling contest on ESPN Plus. This broadcast has been a production of ESPN. You can catch all the replays on ESPN.com. Thank you, everybody, and have a good rest of your Sunday and happy Mother's Day.